please the court, my name is Bill Schmidt, and I represent Mr. Bucci, the appellant in this case. Appellant has cited examples of prosecutorial misconduct. Namely, Bucci has been convicted by plea of two counts of vehicular manslaughter following the 1994 collision. But the prosecutor not only made an objection that kept the jury from knowing this fact, he then repeatedly argued that Bucci got away with it before, that there were four dead bodies on the highway, and that Bucci needed to step up and take responsibility for all his actions. In our briefs, we cited both state and federal cases that were similar or analogous, where similar or analogous behavior was found to be misconduct. We also assigned error to the prosecutor's argument that sometimes people act in conformity with character, and that this was the case with Bucci when he killed two people on Highway 12 in 2006, which mirrored his earlier collision in 1994. Every instance of that misconduct was prejudicial. So prejudicial, we argue, that Bucci was denied his right to a fair trial to due process of law.
You're here, obviously, on federal habeas petition. As I understand it, the California courts found this error, and he found it not to be error, but if it were error, to be non-prejudicial. In light of the facts of this case, which are pretty stark, how can we find that to be a clearly unreasonable finding of fact?
Well, the district court and the state seem to argue that because there's no state Supreme Court precedent directly on point, meaning that there are no facts exactly the same, that we cannot fairly say that the court's interpretation and application of the rule against prosecutorial misconduct was contrary to or an unreasonable application.
I'm asking you a slightly different question. Let's assume this was prosecutorial misconduct. That we find contrary to the state court that it was. But there's a second prong to the Strickland analysis, and that's prejudice. That the outcome probably would, there's a reasonable probability that the outcome would have been different.
Right.
And as I read the state court, there are alternative findings there. They find no misconduct, but if not, no prejudice, no Strickland prejudice. We review that, I think, under epideference. And so my question to you is that finding so unreasonable, the no prejudice finding, that we can overturn it on federal habeas?
Well, I think you've brought two issues into one there. One is the prosecutorial misconduct.
Okay, assume there was prosecutorial misconduct.
Okay.
Assume there was. You've also got to demonstrate prejudice. It's not enough that a prosecutor does something wrong during trial. In order to get reversal, it has to be prejudicial. And the state courts, I think, I may be wrong, correct me if I'm wrong, didn't think there was, I said Strickland before, and I shouldn't have said Strickland, didn't think there was prejudice.
Yeah.
And you got a separate issue on Strickland, that's why I got sidetracked there. So, am I wrong in thinking the state courts didn't find that there was prejudice from the prosecutor's misconduct?
I think I'll get to that if I may continue.
Sure.
The state court, it appears, and the district court seem to argue that there was no precedent. The issue has been raised in a number of contexts, but was best explained by Justice Kennedy when he said, the clearly established federal law relevant here is our decision in Darden v. Wainwright, which explained that a prosecutor's improper comments will be held to violate the Constitution if they so infect the trial with unfairness as to make the resulting conviction a denial of due process. The rule then is pretty general. And Kennedy recognized that 10 years before in Parker, in his concurring opinion in Wright v. West, he said, if the rule in question is one which requires a case-by-case examination of the evidence, then we can tolerate a number of specific applications without saying those applications themselves create a new rule.
Counsel, I have a slightly different question about the same issue. California Court of Appeal held that any objection to the 1994 reference that you're talking about was waived because there was no contemporaneous objection. Is it true that there was no contemporaneous objection and that the only discussion of it came the following day?
The only objection were...
That's a yes or no question.
Yes.
Okay. So is that... So isn't that an independent sort of procedural ground upon which the court could have ruled, not wholly apart from the discussion that Judge Hurwitz is having with you about prejudice?
We're asking this court to make the ruling on federal due process that it was so prejudicial as to infect the trial with unfairness. It was completely unfair to Mr. Bucci to allow the prosecution to do several things.
Well, but as Judge Hurwitz has asked, the state court in the alternative concluded that the prosecutor's comments wouldn't have made any difference given the facts of the case and the eyewitness testimony about, you know, your client's highly reckless driving that caused these deaths. And, you know, we are bound by AEDPA, so why is it unreasonable? It's not enough for us to say, well, gee, if we were going to look at this, we might come to a different conclusion. Why was it unreasonable for the state court to say, even if we reach the merits, it just wouldn't have had much of an effect on the jury?
Because the misconduct of the juror reached a level that denied Mr. Bucci due process.
Well, that's a conclusion, but in order to conclude that it's a denial of due process, there has to be prejudice. I mean, if the misconduct is, you know, making a nasty face at somebody, then, you know, it may be misconduct, but for it to be a due process violation, it has to result in an alteration or probable alteration of the outcome. And that's where we're stuck, I think.
The defense was unable to get evidence that Mr. Bucci was convicted into the trial.
So can we separate two things here? Maybe this will be helpful. I understand from the state court opinion that there may not have been a contemporaneous objection to what was not objected to on the day it occurred. The introduction of the evidence or the prosecutor's...
Prosecutor's comments.
Prosecutor's comments, right.
Prosecutor's comments.
Okay.
In closing and throughout.
Right. So there was no objection at closing or throughout the case to what the prosecutor did.
Correct.
Okay. Now, with respect to that, we then have to find that you haven't waived that as a matter of state law.
We could.
And the California Court of Appeals seemed to think that you might have. So how can we, it's a state law question, not a federal question, how do we get to it?
If state law waiver is applied, our argument is that this violation was so egregious that it was a violation of his federal constitutional
rights. And let's assume that's correct. Let's assume that it was a violation of his federal constitutional rights, but you fail to preserve the issue for state appeal. If that's the case, aren't you out of federal court?
No, because the prosecutor conducted himself in such a way
See, I'm assuming the prosecutor's conduct for purposes of this question was outrageous. I'm also assuming it was prejudicial. Let's assume both of those things, and let's assume that for purposes of my question that you never appealed in state court about that. You wouldn't be able to bring it up in federal court, would you?
No, we wouldn't.
Now, my second question is, given that the Court of Appeal thinks that you didn't preserve the objection at trial sufficiently to allow the appellate court to consider it, aren't we in the same situation?
We're talking about a federal due process violation, and we did exhaust that. It was brought up to the Court of Appeal on the original appeal, to the California Supreme Court on its petition, in the petition for review, in the original appeal, in the case, not the habeas action in the appeal. We did preserve the right or the federal due process issue for prosecutorial misconduct.
Okay. Go on, I'm sorry. We've taken you off track, but I was interested in the issue, Judge Graber.
Okay.
You know, I'm interested in the 404B issue, so if you would address that.
The Strickland issue?
No, the 404B issue as to the admission of the prior acts.
Okay.
Why should this 1994 incident have come in at all? You did object to its introduction. Why?
Well, you're saying it was highly prejudicial. It was supposedly admitted to show that the defendant knew it was dangerous to drive while sleeping. The prosecution didn't present any evidence. In fact, the prosecution argued that Mr. Bucci was not sleeping at the time, and the defense didn't present that defense. So the stated reason for bringing in the evidence was a pretext to bring in character evidence and misconduct evidence, if you will, which was the 1994 accident.
Did Mr. Bucci state to the police at the time that he may have been asleep? At the time of the
accident? He did. Mr. Bucci didn't know what had happened.
Right, no, I'm just, but he did say that at the time.
He did say that he may have fallen asleep. Yes, that was his excuse at the time. But later, and this goes to the ineffective assistance of counsel, it was discovered in the civil trial that he didn't cross over a double yellow line. The pass was initially begun over a dashed or broken yellow line.
What were the results of the civil trial?
A $26 million verdict for the...
So how can we conclude that only if the criminal jury had only heard the same expert testimony that didn't convince the jury in the civil trial, we would have had a different result in the criminal trial? But your ineffective assistance of counsel claim is that if counsel had only explored this expert testimony, it might have come out differently.
Right.
But when you presented... When Mr. Bucci presented that expert testimony in the civil trial, he lost.
Well, he didn't lose. It was a 35-65 split in the responsibility. Caltrans was found 35% liable.
We never
said that Mr. Bucci was not guilty. It's what was he guilty of? Was he guilty of involuntary manslaughter or second-degree implied malice murder? Certainly he was guilty of some sort of homicide. But if the jury had heard that this road was badly designed, there were no shoulders, the sight distance was extremely deficient for a passing area, and there had been over 100 similar accidents over the years, many of them head-on in the same types of accidents and deaths. If they had heard that evidence, all we had to defeat, or the defense would have had to defeat, was the implied malice.
So your contention is he would have been convicted of a lesser offense.
Exactly. Not that he was not guilty, but that it would have been involuntary manslaughter instead of implied malice murder.
Judge, what did you have another question?
My problem with that is that you seem to be cherry-picking elements of the different defenses and ignoring the inconsistency of those defenses. In other words, at some time we have to say, well, what happened? Instead, he's in retrospect going back and picking and choosing among defenses to say, this might have been a better defense.
I agree. You have to cherry pick a defense at the beginning. For the defense counsel to cherry pick the proper defense, a proper investigation, a complete investigation, not a dependence on the prosecution's investigation, had to be made. The defense
counsel, what his client told him.
Well, his client told him, that's another point. His client told him, I don't remember. I might have fallen asleep. I don't remember what happened. So all the defense attorney did was settle on a defense that fit that instead of doing an investigation into what happened and how it happened. it was mathematically proven, and all of the experts at the civil trial agreed that it was not possible for him to have begun the pass illegally.
Counsel, your time has expired, but we'll give you a minute for rebuttal when the time comes.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you.
May it please the Court, Dorian Chung, appearing for respondent and appellant. I'd just like to make a few brief comments. Addressing claim number one, which is a petitioner's argument that the prior misconduct evidence was unlawfully admitted, that claim has been procedurally defaulted. The state appellate court imposed a procedural bar based on the appellant's or petitioner's failure to make a contemporaneous objection at trial.
That's the question I was asking before, so see if you can enlighten me. Was the failure to make a contemporaneous objection to the introduction of the 1994 accident, or was it to the prosecutor's statement?
It was the prosecutor's statement.
Okay. So on the 404B issue, it was preserved?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, so I thought you just said the
opposite. Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I apologize.
I was about to ask that, too.
Okay. I apologize. Allow me to clarify. The admissibility of the prior misconduct evidence was litigated prior to trial in an eliminating motion. The specific misconduct argument, which petitioner is making, referring to prosecutor statements during closing argument, that was a prosecutorial misconduct issue, which would have required a separate and independent objection at the time of trial in order to preserve it. The state appellate court found that petitioner's failure to make a contemporaneous objection constituted a waiver, and that is a separate, independent state law ground.
And did the state appellate court, if I'm not mistaken, then go on to address the
merits,
the merits of it?
It did, of course, Your Honor, and that's correct, but an alternative findings made on the merits does not vitiate the initial imposition of a state law waiver.
Can we address the merits for a second? Because this is the part of this case I find most disturbing. The prosecutor obtains a ruling from the court that the fact that he's been convicted of a misdemeanor can't be introduced into evidence, and then later says to the jury he got away with it. Had he objected, I assume the judge would have admonished the prosecutor, perhaps allowed, I don't know how the judge would have remedied it, but it strikes me as misconduct. Can you defend that at all?
Absolutely, Your Honor. In context, the prosecutor's argument was not an invitation to punish the defendant.
No, I wonder, but it was a misstatement of the facts, was it not? He did not get away with the first incident. He wasn't punished, perhaps, as much as the prosecutor thought he should have been, but he received a criminal conviction for the first, right?
That's absolutely correct, Your Honor. That's absolutely correct.
When one receives a criminal conviction, one does not get away with the underlying conduct, does one?
The problem with that analysis, Your Honor, if I might, is that in context, the prosecutor's statement was not a remark that petitioner had gotten away with committing murder or manslaughter. It was a comment on the fact that his statement at the time of the accident, I must have dozed it off, that had been a successful defense.
But the problem with that argument is it had not been successful. He had been convicted of something.
Yes.
Notwithstanding that defense. So the correct statement was he tried this once before and didn't get away with it. Isn't that correct?
I believe that's incorrect, Your Honor, because what the prosecutor was trying to do was analyze the defendant's specific statement at the time of the accident, which he made to the EMT, which he...
Okay, when did he get away with it before?
He made that assertion in 1994.
And did he get away with it?
He did. That was the assertion he made, and it was accepted, believed, and credited.
How do you know that?
We know that because he was convicted of a misdemeanor at the time. He wasn't convicted of vehicular manslaughter.
Well, you're a great lawyer, but I have trouble thinking that this statement is even close to factually accurate. It may have been waived. There may have been no prejudice, but I think it's misconduct.
Yeah, I guess I had the observation that the IPA standard of review does a lot of work in this case. But I would like to have you comment, if you would, on the question of the accident reconstruction claim, the Strickland claim.
Yes, of course, Your Honor. Probably the most important takeaway from the subsequent reports of the accident reconstruction experts is that they do absolutely nothing to help, aid, or abet the defendant's claim that he was innocent. They do absolutely nothing.
That's not what,
not what he's arguing. He's arguing that had his accident reconstruction testimony been given in the criminal trial, there was a high probability that he would have been convicted of a lesser offense, and that still could be ineffective assistance. If somebody is convicted of murder, but you are convinced that they would only have been convicted of manslaughter, that's a big difference in potential sentence and so forth and so on. So I don't think his claim is that he would have been found innocent. So could you respond to the argument that he's actually making about lesser included?
Of course, Your Honor, and allow me to rephrase my statement then, which is that the testimony of accident reconstruction experts could have done absolutely nothing to contribute towards a finding of a lesser included offense of involuntary manslaughter. The undisputed facts show that the defendant was traveling uphill at night in a no passing zone on a two-lane highway past a line of eastward-bound traffic towards oncoming traffic, which he could not see. He was speeding and plowed directly head-on into a small vehicle, which he never saw and could never have seen.
What's the mens rea required for the crime for which Mr. Bucci was convicted?
Implied malice, Your Honor.
And what's the mens rea required for the lesser included offense of involuntary manslaughter?
It's simply that he would have done
recklessness.
Yes.
Okay, so why wouldn't this testimony have demonstrated that he was merely reckless rather than having the requisite implied malice? I'm not sure how to define implied malice under California law.
Well, as a matter of basic definitions, as a matter of law, this evidence would absolutely have shown he acted recklessly. There's no doubt about that.
Sure, but recklessly would be enough to get him to the lower state crime, would it not?
Of course, Your Honor.
So why wasn't it? So his argument is, had the jury only heard this, there's a reasonable probability that they would have convicted me only of a lesser offense of involuntary manslaughter. You admit that this is testimony that is probative of involuntary manslaughter. Why wasn't it? So why should the counsel have explored this defense?
Because that evidence could never have shown that defendant committed nothing greater.
Well, the only difference, as I understand it, between what the accident reconstructionist said and all the other testimony was whether there was a dotted line at the place where the initial crossover into the other lane took place. But it doesn't seem to me, at least as I understand it, that the accident reconstruction testimony would have altered anything else. And it sounds like your argument is that that small difference really wouldn't have made a difference.
That's absolutely correct. Okay.
Is there anything else I'm missing that would have been different understanding the mechanisms of the accident besides whether there was a broken line at the very beginning when the initial move was made? Is there anything else that's different?
Different from?
From the evidence that came out at the criminal trial. That evidence didn't come out at the criminal trial. Is there?
Yes, and the reconstructionist didn't testify at the criminal trial.
Right.
Had he testified, the jury would have heard what Judge Graber just said.
That right? There was a dotted line at the beginning when he began the passing, even though it became a solid line later during the passing.
That's correct, Your Honor.
Okay. Is there anything else that would have that the accident reconstructionists would have testified to that it was different from what the jury already heard in the criminal trial.
No, Your Honor, because, okay, in fact, the accident reconstruction experts relied mostly on the testimony of Jerry Fender and Kim Johnson. It is that criminal testimony trial which formed the basis of the accident reconstruction reports. So there's nothing that the accident reconstruction experts could have said that would have contradicted or vitiated the testimony of the criminal trial witnesses. Their testimony or the...
So the hail and the speeding and the night and all the other factors are identical.
Yes, absolutely, Your Honor. Those facts remain uncontroverted.
So your argument is that there's not a reasonable probability that it would have changed the verdict?
Or that the state court reasonably so concluded.
Absolutely, Your Honor. That's precisely correct. Yes, that's precisely correct, Your Honor. And, of course, the gravamen of the offense is implied malice. I mean, the findings, the finding of guilt doesn't turn on the exact location where the passing maneuver began.
Well, but I suppose it could. It could be that I negligently set out, and thereafter it was impossible for me to get back. I'm not sure that's a good defense, but it's not contradicted by this other evidence.
Well, our argument, Your Honor, is that under all the circumstances taken together, they demonstrate an abandoned
Oh, sure. Heart. Nobody's arguing about the sufficiency of the evidence to support the verdict. Everybody agrees as to that. The question is whether or not the verdict might have been different in some way had the jury heard this testimony. I think you've argued it.
In that case, if there are no further questions, I am prepared to submit.
I don't believe there are. Thank you. Mr. Schmidt, you have 1 minute.
Judge Hurwitz hit the nail on the head when he said that the defense, or it could have changed the outcome of the trial, in that when he began the pass, he didn't have the one disregard for human life when he began. He got out into the lane and got caught there, but no matter how long it was, whether it was 1 second in the legal passing zone or 10 seconds when he began the pass, he did not have implied malice. That is the theory that we believe could have been presented. In addition, had the evidence of the investigator, or had a proper investigation been done, as it was for the civil trial, it would have been foundational for exculpatory evidence to come in, such as impeachment of the witnesses who said he went over a double yellow line. That just mathematically could not have happened based on the testimony of the experts.
Thank you, counsel. Your time has expired.
Thank you.
We appreciate the arguments of both counsel, and the case just argued is submitted.